Liberty City's been around a long time, you know. Oh, man, there were jazz clubs on every other corner. All parts of Liberty City. Were you hip to that? I moved to Liberty City in 1945, when all you really had to do was put a few dimes in the jukebox and groove. Liberty City groove. There are a lot of bridges that we cross, you know, constantly in life, you know. If I start naming them, I'd probably be here the rest of the evening. Take us to the bridge, of course, the original, Take It to the Bridge. Sonny, Let's Take It to the Bridge. The bridge, in this case, would have been one of the bridges here in Liberty City, you know, where Sonny Rollins was hanging out, practicing during the period when he was taking a long hiatus. And then he came up with a record called The Bridge, and I think a title of one of the compositions was The Bridge. You do the first eight bars, then you go to the bridge, and take it to D, down D, take it to the bridge. So that expression came up quite a bit, you know, with James and Rollins. And so I continue to use it, because we're going to take it back to the bridge anyhow, with the music, of course, and in general. Wow, how you doing, Liberty City? The most popular one when I was a teenager and coming up playing this music was the Lindy Hop, And that was, you know, it was definitely Savoy Ballroom. That's where I had my first gig, and playing at Savoy Ballroom, when the people were really doing the Lindy Hop. You know, bringing the girl up, throwing her around, and, you know, she would have on a wide skirt that would spread out and have on some serious underclothes underneath it. It was very slick looking. It was nice to see, and a lot of action in it, a lot of back and forth and energy. Back in the early days, I'm talking about 40s, 50s, when I first started playing music all over the world, we had to wear shirts and ties and suits and tuxedos up until the 60s. I think that started getting very popular with some of the rock groups. There were guys wearing jeans on stage and all of that, and they were making more money than a lot of the jazz players. So, I mean, why not? Turn off that TV. On TV, I see all that plastic surgery and what do they call it, makeovers? And all that, the new noses and, you know, dun, 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 dun. I don't think it's necessary for me to get plastic surgery. I'm kind of slick, you know, I got a slick nose, you know. Yeah, I'm cool. But I think it would be a great idea to do something serious about the music instead of cursing and thinking that that's hip. It's not hip particularly to use those, you know, four-letter words, and, oh, man, they have, some of them have five and six and seven letters in them. You know, let's speak a little more English that we all can understand and agree with. Hey, motherfucker! Airport security. Now, that is something, even some of the females, man, sometimes a lady would open my bag. I mean, she would just rip my bag open and break the zippers and everything and act pretty mannish and acted like she wanted to kick my butt. I think they should lighten up a little and tighten up in other areas. Cool out, Francis International Airport. You really have to cool out. Please. I was so slick when I was young in school. I used to be playing on the desk with my fingers, drumming on the desk. And all the students in the class would be looking at me and not the teacher and listening to me. Naturally, the teacher didn't dig that at all. Sent me to the principal's office, wrote a note. I don't know what he said in that note, but he must have said I was the worst MF ever or something. Because he said, don't come back to the school unless you bring one of your parents. I went back with my mother. My mother listened to the principal talk about me. I think it was the principal that was talking about me. My mother said, that couldn't be my child. You know. But that's what I was doing, drumming on the desk. So they said, don't come back to you. And I don't think I went back much after that. I said, the hell with that. Definitely stay away from that burger shot, man. You will get more than indigestion. I saw one in the airport yesterday. One of the guys in my band stopped there, and I told him, no, I was going to walk further and check something else out. I went to one of them coffee joints. Bean machine. Look out. Ooh, seriously, jacked up. Some people really get high off of drinking coffee, I think. I mean, they get fired up. on edge, man. A different kind of nervousness. This man, you know, wow. Wow. Coffee. Man, this, I think they got something in coffee, man. It's doing something else that shouldn't be legal. You know, that's something to think about. I met Art Blakey when he was playing with Fletcher Henderson. I was still a teenager in Liberty City, of course. Way back in that period. And he used to call me, I looked very young, you know, when I was a teenager. He used to call me his son. And then maybe some years ago before he passed away, he was having something at one of the theaters. He wanted me to be there. And I went as one of his special guests and I played his solo. And he grabbed me and picked me up. He was so proud of me. And I said at that point that when I was a teenager, he used to call me his son, but now we're all brothers. You know, not the same age. He was a little older than me. Yeah, we were pretty close. And, you know, as I talk about all of these people, most of them are gone, and I'm still out here doing it. And, you know, gets pretty involved when you start talking about it. So I think we better end right there. We have some great tracks right here on Jazz Nation Radio. The worst feeling I think I witness is when I'm walking down the street and there's a lady like right behind me and she's talking and I'm thinking that she's talking to me. And I turn around, I'm answering her, man, and she's talking to her cell phone. That's kind of tricky, you know. You know, maybe that's cool to walk down the street like you just out of a institution or something. You're talking loud, man, the conversation, people don't know what's happening. People don't know what's up with that, you know, in my case anyhow. But hey, cell phones, el strangeo mucho. Now mentioning Miles Davis, the summer of 1950, we both bought automobiles around the same week, and it just happened. Not even realizing we both bought convertibles, different make cars, and we would go racing through the park late at night and or early in the afternoon and get tickets. None of us had a driver's license. And as I look back on that, it was, man, it seemed like a dream, you know. Oh yeah, Liberty City was beautiful, you know, and it was always great. Miles would win the race, but end up getting a ticket of some sort. Probably speeding. You know, that was the thing. I would bump into him many, many years later, and he would be telling all the ladies there, me and Roy Haynes used to smash up our cars and all that. Always having accidents, you know. But those were very beautiful days, man.